And I guess we're live and uncut. All right, so we left off last time talking about significant figures. And now we're going to pick up there and talk about significant figures when you do calculations. So we didn't learn all that because it was fun, because it probably wasn't much fun. We learned it because it's necessary. Whenever you do a calculation with measured numbers, you want your numbers, your calculation results, to reflect how accurate or how precise your measurements were. And it has to do that through significant figures. Now, it's pretty simple. It's nothing really hard. First, we have to learn to round things off. And I'm sure you've all heard of this or done it before. We're going to go over it again. If this is all Greek to you, all brand new, never seen it before, don't worry, it's not hard. The rules, you can read them, you can write them down. The rules are pretty simple, but they're kind of odd to understand until you do examples. And we'll do a bunch of examples. So, when you're rounding off, if the first digit in a number to be dropped is a 4 or less, the digit that preceded it or came before it stays the same, and all the other numbers behind that number, digit, drop off. No problem, we'll do an example, it'll become clear. If the first digit to be dropped is a 5 or greater, then the first remaining digit or the digit right before it goes up by 1. And the rest of the numbers after that drop off. That's it. Those are the rules. They're pretty simple. And just reading them, I'm sure none of you really understand it. All right, let's get to some examples. If we wanted to round off 8.4234 to 3 and 2 significant figures, let's make it a little more fun. Let's round them off to 3, 2, and 1 significant figure. So we have 8. Oh, that's no good, is it? So we have 8.4234. And we want to round it off to 1 sig fig, 2 sig figs, and 3 sig figs. Okay, first of all, let's look at the number. 8.4234. How many sig figs is that? 5. 8.4234, the only number written there. That's 5 significant figures. So now we want to round it to 1 significant figure. So this is my first significant figure, isn't it? The 8, right? That's my first significant figure. So I want to round it to have only 1 sig fig. You follow me? So now the first number that's going to be rounded away is a 4. So that's the first number that's going to be rounded away. The 4 is less than 5, right? So the preceding digit, the 8, must stay the same. So the answer in one significant figure would be 8. The 4, 2, 3, 4 just kind of what I call rounds away. Some people say it drops off. I say rounds away. Okay, so now, if we want to have 2 significant figures, so now instead of 1, we want 2 significant figures. The 8 is my first significant figure. The 4 is my second one. So therefore, we're looking now at this 2. The 2 is the first digit that will round away. 2 is less than 5, right? So the 4 must stay the same. So it's 8.4. Follow that? Everybody cool with that? It's not a hard concept, but it does get tricky in example 3. There's some nuances that we'll show you. It's not that tricky, but everyone's okay with these easy examples? All right, so now we want to have 3 significant figures. So now, 1, 2, 3, there's my third significant figure. So now we're looking at that 3. So 8.423, the 3 is the first digit we're looking at to round away. The 3 is less than 5, so the answer must be?
8.42.
Very good. Let's do one more, 4 sig figs. More examples are better than less. So now, that's 3 sig figs. We want to round that answer to 4. What would the answer be? Anybody? 8.42? Nice. 8.423. That's four significant figures. So far, so good? All right. Moving on to example two, 14.7. This one's a little trickier. I want to round that digit, or that number, to one significant figure. So this is my first significant figure, right? So okay, the digit beside it is a 4, which is less than 5, is that correct? So what's my answer? People want to say 1, don't they? So people want to say 1. Let's talk about the answer 1. Why can't that be right? Because 1 is way less than 14, right? So it can't be 1, it must be 10. Right? See that? It has to be 14, or sorry, 10. Now, when you round a number off, it doesn't mean the digit goes away. It just means that number has to go away. For example, this number is 10, is in the tens. 16s. When you round that digit off, it doesn't go away to oblivion, it just becomes a zero. The zero is a placeholder. It tells you the magnitude of the number. It tells you the number is bigger than one, basically. It tells you it's 10. Okay? Now, this is a great example. Do you see why rounding off to one significant figure, if all your measurements are so bad that you have to round to one significant figure, do you see why that's a crappy deal? What if the bank were to round your bank deposit off to one significant figure? Wouldn't that make you mad? Especially if it rounded it down, which it's going to do because it's a bank. Right? That would make you mad, right? The more significant figures, the better for you, right? You know what I mean? Like, for example, look at Donald Trump. He's worth some quadrillion dollars. Like, say he's worth, like, you know, $548 million. That's what we say. Do you think Donald Trump has $548 in assets? $1 million in assets? No. He's got 5,048,365,000, you know, on to an exact decimal point, right? Many significant figures in that number. But you're not going to report all of those because maybe you can't. Or maybe your measurements are bad. You have to round. So does everyone see why that's 10? Does everyone see why rounding to one significant figure is crappy? Because you lose 40%. See what I'm saying? Everybody? All right. Now, next, we went around to two significant figures. So now, instead of the one, we're looking at the four. So we want to keep the, wrong thing. Here we go. Right here, we're looking at the seven now. So we have a 14.7. So the seven is the first digit we're going to round away. So now, what will the answer be? 15. Do you see how significant figures improves our precision accuracy? All right. Now you went around to three significant figures. So now instead of the seven, we are looking at the eight. So the eight is the first digit to round away. So the answer must be 14 point. Does everyone see why it's eight? Everybody? 14.8 is very good. All right, finally, four sig figs. So now, the 8 is no longer what we're looking at. We're looking at the 0, 14.780. So the 0 is 0 less or less than 5? Less. So what must the answer be? 14.78. Very nice. Okay. 3, 2, 5, 6. Okay, let's round that off to one significant figure. So we have a 3 here, and the 2 is the first digit we're looking at. So we have $3,256. We want to round that to one significant figure. What would the answer be? 3,000. Everyone agree? Okay, whenever you do numbers like this and you're wondering if you know if it's 3 or 3,000, think of it in terms of your own money. If you had $3,256, and someone took $256, or took actually $3,000 away from you, you'd be mad, right? So this is 3,256, rounded to one significant figure, you would say 3,000. Everyone got it? Everybody? A few of you do. Okay. Now we're going to round to two significant figures. So without any help from me, what do you think the answer would be in two significant figures? 1,300 or 3,300, right? That's correct. All right, let's go to three significant figures. Someone who hasn't answered yet, or people who haven't answered yet, yell out. Three significant figures. Maybe everyone's already answered once, so no one wants to say anything. 3,260. Is that right? Yeah. Everybody? Yeah. Very nice. Now, to round it to four, it's already in four. So you just put the same number. 3, 2, 5, 6. Okay. Does anyone think that's like Martian? Like alien? Can't do it. It's too difficult. It's pretty easy, right? There's nothing earth-shattering. If you've taken any kind of math, you've already done this kind of stuff. Now, I want to ask you a question. How do I round that number? So looking at just the 3,000, just look at 3,000. How do I round that to two significant figures? Or how do I indicate two significant figures with that number? Okay. How many significant figures are in this number? How many? One. There's no decimal point at the end of the zero, so there's only one significant figure, right? So if I put a decimal point here, that's four significant figures, right? So how do I indicate two? Because sometimes you'll run into that. You'll have a number that you're supposed to round to two significant figures, but you can't because there's all these zeros that are preventing you from doing it. So how would you do it? There has to be. What'd you say? Scientific notation. Excellent. You put it into scientific. You follow me? The answer would be 0.0 times 10 to the 3. That is two significant figures, right? Does that make sense? Everybody, can you all do that now? Because that happens, for those of you in the lab, that happens in the lab, and that will happen in the course. And I will tell you right now, I don't mean to do that. It just kind of happens. I don't know why my mind does that. If you take organic chemistry, the answer is S. Don't worry about it. Just tell your friends in organic to guess S. All right. And I don't know why I do that. I just do. So that's rounding. Okay? So that's what you got to do once you get an answer from your calculator. So your calculator is going to give you a bunch of digits, and you, the human being, have to know when to round and what to round to. All right. Oops, let's do this learning check real quick. Do it yourself. Work with a partner if you want to. So let me tell you when 3.1457 grams is rounded to 3 and 2 sig figs. Take 3 minutes and do that. And I'll do it on the board and we'll see if you're right. I'm sure you will be. Easy, right? You can do it. Everyone in this room can do it. It's not that hard. It's cold, though. Man. Move to sunny South Florida, where the weather never goes below 70. Yeah, except for today. How's everyone doing? Anyone got it? Who's got it done? Who doesn't have it done? Who doesn't care? Oh, good. You all care. That's nice. I'm glad. All right, 3.1457 to three significant figures. So 3.1457, I want to round that to 3 sig figs. So what would the answer be in three significant figures? 3.15, right? So that would be the answer in three significant figures. And that same thing in 2 sig figs. It would be 3.1. How's everyone do? Clap your hands. See, it's like a little golf clap. Come on. Okay, I can't hear you. I'm sorry. Yeah, you normally would, but I'm lazy. It's cold. My mind's not up yet. Okay. Everyone's pretty confident with that. Excellent, excellent, excellent. Now, rules. I'm going to give you some time to write these rules down. Just write the rules down. Do not write the example, because I'm going to go over the example with you on the board. Just write that rule real quick. The rule makes no sense until you see it in examples, but just write it down. When you multiply or divide measured numbers, the number of significant figures in your answer has to reflect the measurement with the least amount of significant figures. What? What do you even say? It's simple. But please write the rule down, and we'll go over a few examples, and you'll be like, oh, that's all you mean? That's all I mean. When multiplying or dividing significant digits or measured numbers, your final answer must reflect the measurement with the least number of figures. So write it down, then we'll do the example real quick. The example is the only way to learn science, in my opinion. While you're writing it, take a mental note. The rules for multiplication and division are not the same as adding and subtracting. So we're going to go over that too. Pesky sick fix. All right, you got it all written down? All right, read the example with me. We're going to multiply the following measured numbers. 24.66 multiplied by 0.35 centimeters. All right, so 24.66 centimeters multiplied by 0.35 centimeters. Equals. Now, if you got your calculator, just go ahead and type it in, a little bit of practice for you. Hopefully, you'll get 8.631. That's what the calculator will show you. Now, whenever you're working with a calculator, remember, it's a silicon-based thing. It's not living. It's just there to do whatever you ask it to do. It's going to give you its best guess at an answer. Now, the answer that it's displaying, 8.631, is incorrect. It's close, but it's technically incorrect. Let's look at the measurements. So you have a box or a flower garden or whatever, you're trying to measure its area. And you measure the long side with a tape measure, and you get 24.66 centimeters. Pretty small flower box. And you get the width is 0.35 centimeters. Really small flower box. You might be lucky to get one flower. And you multiply them together. Now, this measurement here has how many significant figures?
Four.
Does everyone see four there? So there's four sig figs right here. You may even want to indicate that. Four sig figs. This one has how many? Everybody? Louder.
Two.
The zero is a placeholder. The 3.5 is the significant part. So there's two sig figs. So when you multiply one number by the other, you're going to get 8.631. That's what the calculator is going to tell you. That is technically not correct. This has four sig figs. This has two. Your answer must mirror, right, your answer must mirror the measurement with the least significant figures, which is this one. This one only has two. So your answer can only have two. You follow me? So you must round that to two significant figures. One, two, so you're going to look at the three. The 3 is less than 5, so you must just round those numbers away. So it'll be 8.6 centimeters squared. Sound good? That's as hard as it gets. Now, I can make it harder, but that's pretty much as hard as it gets. Okay? Yeah? I will do another example. I'll do one better. Because doing one example is not nearly enough. We'll do a few. I promise. We'll make sure that you're good to go. And here it is. Example 2. 21.5 centimeters multiplied by 0.30 centimeters, all that divided by 1.88 centimeters. So, later, go ahead and punch that in the calculator. See what you get. How did you do? Did you punch it in the calculator? Type it all in there? What did you get? What did the calculator tell you?
3.43.
Yep, tell me.
0851064.
Now you could write all those down and then round it off on your exam, which a lot of students do. A lot of students would just write that whole string of numbers down because it makes them feel comfortable. That's fine. And then you would round it from there. That's cool. If that's what you want to do, write all that string of numbers down and then round it to your final answer. Or if you're really confident, you can just look at your calculator and round it from your calculator. It's up to you, however you want to do it. Okay, let's look at these measurements. How many significant figures in that one?
Three.
How many?
Three.
Everybody?
Three.
Three. Everyone yell it in unison because that makes everyone wake up. Three, sig, fig. How many here?
Two,
very good, nice and loud. How many here?
Three.
Okay, so of all three of these measurements, which one is your worst one? Or your one with the least sig figs? 0.30, the one with 2. So your answer must have how many significant figures?
2.
So you're going to round it looking at the 3. So there's my first sig fig, there's my second one. The 3 is the first digit I want to consider. It's less than 5, or it's 4 or less, however you want to say it. So the answer would be 3.4 centimeters. Okay? Better? Examples, they work magic, don't they? Now the thing about examples is I can do them all day long because I'm pretty good at this stuff. You guys want to go home and do problems on the do the practice problems on mastering chemistry, those ones count for points, so do the ones on desire to learn, and do the ones in your textbook, okay? This is a kind of get down like bang, bang, bang. And here's the deal. On an exam, if I give you a question worth 10 points, and you don't round it properly, that's minus 1 point. If you leave off the unit, that's minus 2, okay? So one for leaving off the unit. Out of 10, now you've gone from an A to a B just by doing that. Okay? So be very mindful of that. The units and rounding it properly are very important. Okay. Another example. Multiply and divide the following. So we got 6.0 grams divided by 2.00 grams. Give that one a try. Oops. Go ahead. Yep, it would be. Here, let me erase this and write it back up.
Okay.
So you got centimeters multiplied by centimeters, but then you did a final step of dividing by centimeters.
Okay.
So that multiplies to be centimeters squared divided by centimeters,
mm-hmm.
which becomes centimeters again.
Okay. Okay. Thank you.
You're welcome. Okay. This one's a little tricky. This one you got to be kind of careful with. 6.0 divided by 2.00. Most of you can do it in your head. That's 3, right? Everybody? But now you got to be really careful when you're dealing with chemistry or science. Because you want to indicate to your reader how good your measurements were. So we have 6.0 grams divided by 2.00 grams. Here is going to say 3. That's what the calculator is going to say. How many sig figs in that number? 2 sig fig. How many in that number? Everybody? This one? 2. Who says 2? It's 3. The bottom one's got 3 sig figs. Because of the zeros, 2.00 is 3 significant figures. After the zeros, if there's a real number in front of the decimal point, like a 1, 2, or a 3, and every digit after the decimal point at that point is significant. So 2.00 is 3, 2.000 is 4. Is that okay? Good. So there's 3 significant figures right here. So the top one has 2, the bottom one has 3. So my answer must have 2. But that's only 1. So you, because you're the human being, must put in a 0. Because it's 3.0. That tells the reader that your measurements were good to provide you with 2 significant figures. Okay? Now, gardening or, you know, rough carpentry or something like that, significant figures, like having 2 or 3, don't really matter much. But if you start building cabinets, you know, the cabinet maker is going to go out to 2 or, you know, 4 or 5 significant figures maybe. You start building parts for race cars, they're going to go out to many more significant figures because they want much more precision. You start building space station parts, you're talking about lots of significant figures because they want it to fit. They only get one chance at it. You know what I mean? So that's when it becomes important. So in your day-to-day life, measuring dirt for the garden probably doesn't matter that much. One significant figure is probably good. If you're starting to build precision auto parts or space shuttle parts, more significant figures definitely will matter. All right, give that one a try on your own. Centimeters, multiply that by 3.408 centimeters. All that divided by 2.00. Okay, how many sig figs in that number?
3.
Everybody? Everybody awake out there? How many in that number?
4,
very good. 4 SF, or 4 sig figs. How many in the bottom number?
3.
3, very good. Okay, so what's the digit with the, or what's the number with the least significant figures?
3.
There's a 5.00 and a 2.00. They're the 3 sig figs. So your answer has to have how many?
3.
What is your calculator? 8.52. That's it? Wow, look at you. So, is that answer correct?
Yes.
Yes, but now you have to put in your unit, right? There you go. 8.52. Oh, lucky. That worked out really well for you guys. Okay. So far, so good, right, guys? Not too bad? All right, here's the rules for addition and subtraction. They are different than multiplying and dividing, so write them down, please. When you add and subtract, the final answer, the decimal final answer must mirror the decimal points in the measured number with the least amount of decimal points. That sounds totally foreign, but just write it down. When we do examples, it'll be very, very clear. very, very clear. We'll do the example together as soon as you get it written down. Let's change some color up here. Wow, the final answer is written so that it has the same number of decimal places as the measurement. Oh, but whoa, that's like reading Greek. Everybody got it? Close? Now please, whatever you do, don't confuse the rules for adding and subtracting and apply them to multiplying and dividing, because you'll be very, very unhappy. And don't apply the rules for multiplying and dividing to adding and subtracting. That'll make you even more unhappy. All right, so we're going to add three numbers together. 2.012, 61.09, and 3.0. What I would do if I were you is I would write the numbers down the same way they have them up on the screen there. When you're first starting this, you want to do things that make you do the right answer or make you get the right answer. So line up all the digits, the tens in the tens place, the ones in the ones place, the hundreds in the hundreds place, and so on. And it'll become clear in a minute why I'm doing that. So just line them up nice and neat, one on top of the other. So the decimal points line up. Everything lines up. The tens line up, the ones line up, the one tenths, the one hundredths, the one thousandths, they all kind of line up. And then, with a different color marker if you like, or a pen or pencil, find the number with the fewest decimal points, which in this case would be the 3.0. And I would just draw a line straight up like this, to just to the right of your number with the fewest decimal places. That line is to kind of remind me where I need to round. So I type all this stuff into my calculator, and I get 66.102. So that's the answer my calculator would give me. Everything on the left-hand side of the line, of this green line right here, I'm going to want to keep. Everything to the right-hand side of it, I'm going to want to round away. But I have to round it using the rules for rounding. You follow me?
I'm sorry.
Which part?
Everything to the side.
Right on. So you draw your straight line down, right? You draw it just to the right of the number with the fewest decimal points, which is the 3. So I drew my green line right there. Everything to the left of the green line you're going to want to keep. Everything to the right of the green line you're going to want to round away. Okay? That's what you want to try to, what you want to try to do. So here, the first digit we're going to round away is a 0, right? So you're going to want to round the 1 and leave it as a 1. Is that correct? So the answer will be? Right, everyone? It's confusing, isn't it? Well, we'll do another example.
I have a question. Go ahead. I thought you were saying it has to be the same number as the fewest decimal. Wouldn't that be 2 points?
No, be 1. Because see here? 3.0 has 1 decimal point.
Oh, you mean after the decimal?
Yep.
Mm-hmm. Oh, okay.
Mm-hmm. All right. So far, so good? I think there's another example for that. If not, I'll make one up. Go ahead.
So it would be after the decimal point of just 1 number?
This number here has 1 decimal point. This one has 2, and that one has 3. Uh-huh. So your answer can only have 1. If you give it 2 or 3, it would be wrong. It can only have 1. Okay? I think there's another example. Yeah, here we go. Example 2. 65.09 minus 3.0. So it's the same rules apply. Just now, instead of adding, you are subtracting. Okay, here we go. 65.09 grams minus 3.0. So line up the ones with the ones, the tens with the tens, the one tenths with the one tenths, and all that. Find your number with the fewest decimal points, which is the 3.0. And I personally like to draw a line like that. So that way I can kind of remind myself where I have to round. Now, once you get good at this, you can just look at your calculator, look at your numbers, and round it, and probably do it in your head. While you're getting used to it, I would write everything down. So this answer would be 68.09. I'm sorry, I'm adding it. 62.09. 62.09. There we go. So that will be the answer I hope the calculator will give you. Now, we're going to round everything off after this line. So here's my line that tells me where to round. I'm going to round everything off after here. If you want to look at it another way, just count the decimal points. Here I have one, here I have two. So my answer can only have one decimal point, right? Not significant figures, decimal points. Okay? So the answer would be 62.1 grams. Is that better? Becoming clear? Everybody? A few people. Let's do another example then. Okay. If I take 34.31 grams and I add it to 114.0 grams, and then I add 10.000 grams. Oops, let me just make that a little bigger. So, if I want to add those numbers together, on the top number, 34.31, how many decimal points does that number have?
Two.
Two. On the middle number, 114.00, how many decimal points?
Two.
Two, right? On the bottom number, 10.000, how many decimal points?
Three.
Three. My answer must have?
Two.
Exactly. Add those up and tell me what the calculator tells you, please. Well, it probably didn't tell you the zero, right? Is that what the calculator said? Something like that? Is that answer correct?
No.
It is right, isn't it? I set it up to be correct, because, you know, I'm trying to be nice. All right, does everyone see why that number is correct?
Yeah.
Is everyone comfortable with that?
Yeah.
Is anyone not comfortable with it? So if I gave you a quiz right now worth 15 bonus points in your first exam, you'd get it right?
Yes.
Yes, okay, well that tells me that you know how to do it. I'm not going to do that though. 15 bonus points, maybe two bonus points, 15, wow. Try that one. Everybody got it? Top number, 82.409. How many decimal points?
Three.
Three. How many on the bottom number?
One.
So your answer must have? Everybody? You all agree? All right, let's set that up real quick. 82.409. And that's milligrams. Adding 22.0 to that. So your answer would be? 904401. Is that what the calculator gave you?
Mm-hmm.
So you're going to round it off to what number?
104.4.
Did everyone agree?
Yes.
I'm not saying it's right. Does everyone agree?
Yes.
No. Good. Who said no? What do you think it's going to be?
104.
Okay. Here's why it's not 104. It's good for you for being brave and saying what you think. Doesn't matter that it's not right. We're going to learn here together, me and you. So now, this number has one decimal place, right? And this number has three, right? So your answer has to have?
One.
Right? You follow me now?
Yes.
Okay, let's just imagine, me and you, we're going to imagine now. Let's imagine this one had two decimal places, so 0.00. Okay, you with me now? So then you'd have to have two decimal places. Okay? Now, what if this one had none? Then the answer would have?
None.
No decimal points.
So what
if you think it's based off the measurement with the least decimal points. It could be the bottom number, it could be the top number, it could be somewhere in the middle. Aha, see? That's a common mistake. Very common mistake. Don't confuse those rules. Because you get a very bad day. Yeah, it's a very common error. People do that all the time. Try not to do that. Best advice I can give you, try not to do it. I'll tell you how to avoid that. Practice. The more you practice, you'll make that mistake at home in your, you know, as you're doing your homework. And then you'll not make the mistake again. And then come exam time, you'll rattle these questions off like there's nothing and you move on to the harder ones. See what I'm saying? If you get stuck on questions like this, the harder ones you don't have any time to do. So, all right. Prefixes and equalities. We've already discussed this. I usually go over this at the very beginning of class. So this is like millimeters and meters and all that stuff. So we've already done this. So I'm just going to blow over it because we've already done it. Okay? I like to introduce metric early on in this course. Some professors do it later. The book does it later. I put it in early. Okay? So I just blew over 1.7 because we've already done it. Okay? Getting conversion factors. Now here is where this course gets to be a little bit more fun, at least in my opinion. Conversion factors are a big deal. Now I've talked to people, the professors at the nursing school, I've spoken to them, and I've had students come back and report that this is actually very true. They give you a test, I'm not sure how often they give it to you, that's all conversion factors. It says, can you convert? And you have, and they're going to show you their exact way to do it. They have a very detailed way that they force you to learn how to do it. And that's how, I guess, hospitals want you to report it on charts. I don't really know why they do it that way, but that's how they do it. So you have to know how to convert. So you may as well learn now at least the basics on how to convert. So when you get to the nursing program, learning their detailed procedure won't be daunting to you because you already know kind of how to do it. All right, conversion factors. These little things called equalities. Equalities is a fancy word to mean this equals that. An equality just means that equals that. So it relates two things together. So for example, what equality? 1 meter is 1,000 millimeters. 1 meter equals 1,000 millimeters. That's an equality. One thing equals another. 15 sprockets equals 19 gaskets. That will be an equality. It's a weird one, but it's still an equality. 2 WYSIWYGs equals 15 smorgasbords. Doesn't make any sense, but it's an equality. This equals that. One that makes more sense, 1 pound is 16 ounces. So if I could say, hey, this thing right here weighs 16 ounces. And you could say, oh, okay, it weighs a pound. They mean the same thing, right? They're both referring to the same amount of force being exerted on something. 1 kilogram is 2.20 pounds. So if I say I have 1 kilogram on Earth, that would weigh 2.20 pounds. Follow me? One thing equals another. That's just relating two things with different units together. No big deal, right? Just equalities. Now, equalities between units, write this down. This is very important, so I'm going to give you some time to write this. The same system of measurements are definitions that are used as exact numbers. Now, what does that mean? Basically, the top, I'm talking about the top point now, the same system of measurement, blah, blah, blah. What I'm saying is, if you have an equality that's defined, say for example, 1 meter equals 1,000 millimeters. That's a definition. It's been, you know, scientists have said this will equal that. That means they're exact numbers. Now an exact number, exact numbers are different than measured numbers. Exact numbers. Are defined. Or counted. So they're defined or they're counted. So if I define something, say 16 ounces and a foot, That's a definition. Or sorry, 12 inches in a foot, 16 ounces in a pound. That's a definition. If I say there's 1,000 millimeters in a meter, that's a definition. Those are exact numbers. Now, what does that mean? That means those numbers have infinite numbers or infinite significant figures. So 1 meter equals 1,000 millimeters. That's 1.00000000 infinity meters equals 1,000 decimal 0000000 infinity millimeters. Now this little sign here is my little messy infinity sign. The zeros will go on for eternity. They will not stop. That's an exact number. Okay? So a definition. 1 pound equals 16 ounces. 1.00000000000 pounds equals 16.00000000 ounces off into infinity. You follow what I'm saying? Those numbers have infinite significant figures. Never ever round to them. You'll never use a rounding thing for those because they have infinite significant figures. Counting. An exact number is also counted. I can look in this room, I can count the students in this room. That number will be exact because I can't get a fraction of a student, which would be really messy. Okay? So if I count, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, there's 29 of you in this room. There's exactly 29 students in this room because I can count you. If I drop some change on the table, I can count how many coins there are. That's an exact number. That's different from a measured number. A measured number is one that is measured, if you wanted to say it that way. One that you have to use a device to get the value. A measured number is determined by measurement. So the length of this table, I can get a ruler or a tape measure. I can measure the length of that table. But that length is measured. So I had to use a measuring device, a tape measure, to figure out how long that table is. Say 1.34 meters. Now, is it 1.341? 1.34? We don't know, because we only went to three significant figures. Do you see what I'm saying? That number is not exact. When you weigh yourself in the morning, you do not weigh exactly what you think you weigh. You weigh a little bit more or probably a little bit less, okay? Because your scale can only read to so many significant figures. Most of them read to three. So if you get a good one, it might read to four. But say you weigh yourself and you say you weigh 0.2. Are you 110.2 or 110.23? That, you know, you don't know because that last significant digit is not told to you. See what I'm saying? So that's a measurement. So there's counting, those are exact, definitions, those are exact, and measurements, those are not exact. You follow that? Everybody? Kind of okay? All right. So, equalities. In measurement, those equalities are exact. So when you're in the same unit, the same system, so when you're in metric, all metric conversions are exact. So if I'm going to convert from meters to millimeters, that's an exact. If I'm going to convert from pounds to ounces, that's an exact conversion because it's in the same system of measurement. Is that okay? A little bit? So if I convert from pounds to ounces, that's exact, right? Because they're both in the English system. If kilograms to grams, that's in the metric system, so that's an exact conversion. Does that make sense? If I convert from grams to pounds, now I'm leaving metric, going to English. That's not exact, is it? That has to be measured. Does that make sense? Everybody? If I take a baby, weigh its weight in pounds, and I convert that to kilograms, I'm going from English to metric. I'm jumping to a different system of measurement. That's a non-exact conversion. Okay? Is that okay? Everybody? Please say yes or no. Yes. The exception, please write that exception down if you haven't already done so. Please circle it and underline it. The exception to that rule is the following. 1 inch equals 2.4 centimeters, 2.54 centimeters, excuse me. I'll give that to you on an exam. Don't memorize that. I will give you that number on an exam. That conversion has been defined by the powers that be to be an exact conversion. So 1 inch equals 2.54 centimeters is considered to be an exact conversion, even though you're jumping from one system to another. Don't ask me why, it just is. Just accept that it is, because I honestly don't know why they've done that. It just kind of is. Now here, don't write any of this down, just look. This table, this exact table, this one right here, will be on every exam you write. Except the metric system will be blanked out. I'll put a piece of paper over it and photocopy it so you can't see the metric system. You will have the metric to US or English system. You will have the US system, but you will not have metric. Metric, you must know metric. You must. Every scientist in the world must know the metric system. So don't memorize conversions. Don't memorize any metric to US conversions. Just know the metric system. Go ahead. Yeah, I'm going to just put a blank that out. You won't even be able to see it. But everything else will be there. Even the time will be there, even though everyone knows the time. Go ahead. Oh. What else? Okay, so don't memorize conversion factors unless they are in metric. Okay. Conversion factor. Equalities, conversion factors, they're more or less the same thing. But they're slightly different, but they're more or less the same thing. So. If you're given an equality, let's say, you can use the example there or you can use this one. Let's say 1 kilogram equals 1,000 grams. Let's say that. Well, that's actually true. 1 kilogram equals 1,000 grams. This written right here is an equality. That equals that. That's an equality. That you can easily convert to a conversion factor. All you got to do is put one over the other. 1 kilogram divided by 1,000 grams. You could write it this way. 1,000 grams divided by 1 kilogram. These are conversion factors. This is an equality. Do you see how they're basically the same thing? All three are basically saying the same thing. So now, you might be given a bunch of, you will be given a bunch of equalities on an exam. You just have to know that you can put one of these over the other. So kilograms over grams or grams over kilograms. No problem. Please take a note that the one followed the kilogram. The 1,000 followed the grams. The numbers stayed with the units. The biggest mistake, or one of the most common mistakes I will see, is students will transpose them. They will put 1,000 kilograms over 1 gram. That's a very common error. I don't know why people do it. The one always stays with the kilograms. The 1,000 always stays with the grams. Don't switch them. So this is completely wrong. And you'll get really big and bad numbers that way. So don't do that. The number follows the unit. Go ahead. I'll show you. We're going to get there. But you're good for you for jumping ahead. But we're going to get there.
I did my homework.
You did, I can tell. Good for you. See how much easier the class is when you do your homework? All right. So now, let's skip over. That's too easy for you guys. I want to get to conversion factors, writing problems. So when you're looking at conversion factors, you may not be given this equals that. It may be written in the question. So if you look at these questions, example one, the price of 1 pound of red peppers is $2.39. That's an equality, believe it or not. If you look at that question carefully, the price of 1 pound of peppers is $2.39. Read that question carefully. You could actually pull out an equality. So let's see here. We have 1 pound. So 1 pound. LB is the abbreviation for pound. 1 pound of red peppers is? A lot of times in math questions, especially word problems, you can read the word is as equal. Sometimes. Most times it works, actually. 1 pound of red peppers is or equals $2.39. So 1 pound of red peppers equals $2.39. So if you walked into a store with a pound of red peppers, don't try this, it won't work. I've tried. They will give you $2.39. If you walk into the store with $2.39, they will give you a pound of peppers. See what I'm saying? One thing equals another. Is that okay with you guys? Now, this is a follow-up to this question. What if you had $5? So how much, or how many, I should say, how many pounds of red peppers can you buy with $5? So if you had $5, you walked into the store, how many pounds of red peppers could you buy? Using this equality, you can figure that question out. Let's leave it for now. We'll come back to these kind of questions in a minute. But this is where we're going. This is where we're going to answer these kinds of questions. So just leave it for now. We'll jump back to it. The cost of 1 gallon of gasoline is $2.89 back in the good old days. So that's telling you something. 1 gallon of gas is $2.89. If you have $2.89, you can buy a gallon of gas. Okay? 1 gallon of gas equals $2.89. That's what it means. All right? So everyone's okay with that? All right. So these are equalities. And equalities can be written, let's go back to our red peppers. 1 pound peppers divided by $2.39. Or you could say $2.39 divided by 1 pound peppers. All right. So you got the gas, you got the peppers. Now, does everyone see how I got the equality and how I got the conversion factors? Every equality should give you at least 2 conversion factors. Some give you, well, I don't think they give you more than that. Everyone's okay. So now, let's walk into Publix with our $5 and tell the manager we want to max out our green pepper allotment. So how many pounds of green peppers can we buy, or red peppers, I guess they are, with our $5? Here's how I would approach it. Now, if you can't follow along really closely right now, we're going to do umpteen examples of this kind of stuff, so don't worry. You're not going to be left in the lurch. Okay. So we have $5. So let's write that down. $5. And at the end of the day, equals pound pepper. Is that true? We have $5, and at the end of the day equals how many pounds of red peppers, right? That's what we're trying to get at. We know the conversion factors. Okay. So now we're going to do a math question. We're going to do a mathematical question. If, just think about this in terms of math. If I want to get rid of that dollar sign, just the unit dollar sign, how would I do it? Divide by dollar signs, right? Right? Don't say that word anymore. That's an evil, dirty word. Math people use it. Scientists hardly ever use it. We're going to divide by dollar signs, right? Just think of it that way. We're going to divide by dollar signs. Does that make sense? Because we want to divide out so the units will cancel, right? So in science, we say multiplies by something and put the dollar sign on the bottom. That's a mathematical expression. That means $5 divided by dollar signs. Okay? So does that mean the dollar sign should cancel? Using math, the dollar sign should go away, shouldn't they? Everybody? So what do we put here? We want this to be in the end. So what do we put up here? These are the units you want. So what units do you put here? You want these units. So what units do you put here? No. Don't go too fast. You want these units. So what unit do you put right there?
Pounds.
Pounds of? Peppers. LB peppers, right? So that's how the units have to look. The worst thing you can do, if you're not good at this, if you've done it in high school and you're really good at it, do it, just go for it. The worst thing you can do is jump and start putting numbers everywhere. Because if you start putting numbers everywhere, you're going to put them in the wrong place. Put the units in. That's what I'm trying to do, yeah. Yeah. I'm just saying it a little differently. Okay. So everyone follows that, right? That's why the units are set up the way they are? Yes, no? Maybe so? So what's going to cancel out here? The dollar signs, right? So the dollar signs will cancel. And that will leave us in that unit, is that correct? Pounds of pepper? Yes? Maybe? So then what number goes here? Who else knows the number? What goes here? You're saying it very timidly.
One.
What number has to go here?
One.
How do I know that? Because the number one goes with that unit, right?
Yeah.
Everybody okay with that?
Yeah.
You guys seem a little flabbergasted by that. What number goes down here? 2.39. Okay. Does that make sense?
Mm-hmm.
Does anyone not think that makes sense? So divide 5 by 2.39. What is it? 11? It can't be 11. 2.09. Okay, does that seem logical? Right? Does that seem logical? Okay, that number does seem logical. Does everyone agree that number? With $5, if the price of something is $2.39, if you had $5, you could get just over 2 pounds.
Yeah.
If your number over here was like 20 or something, obviously that's not right, because 20 is going to cost you $40 or so, right? Everyone?
Yeah.
Just basic math, right? All right.
I'm multiplying
something. Yeah, I know. I knew. But see, that's why you set the units up, so the units tell you what to do. Don't worry, we're going to do a million and one examples of this. Yes. Yep. But $5 is an exact number. Money. Always think of money as exact.
Oh, okay.
If you have $5, you have $5. 5.00.
Okay.
If you have $5.15, you have 5.15. Now, if your friend just goes, I got around $5, you know he's got 4, right?
Okay.
Percent factor. So now, if you're given a percentage, that is also an equality. Now, everyone looks at percentages, and they always get kind of freaky on me. They always think that it's really hard. It's not really hard. Here's how you want to look at percentages. If you're given on an exam a percentage and you want to use that as an equality, it's really simple. Just do it this way. Let me get this board erased and I'll show you how easy it can be. If you want to do a percentage. So here we're saying we have food with 30% fat by mass. So we have 30% fat by mass. So mass, you know, grams, kilograms, right? Milligrams, could even be. So if you go to the grocery store, you pick up some hamburger, it says 30% fat by mass. What does that mean?
Well, just
give me an example. What does that mean, do you think? 30% by mass. So you have a kilogram, let's say. So a kilogram of hamburger. It's 30% fat by mass. What does that mean? 30% of the whole thing, right, is fat. Does that make sense? So of all that pound you're going to purchase, 30% of that kilogram is fat, right?
Yes.
We're okay with that? So if it's 30% fat by mass, let's make our numbers really simple. Let's say we have 100 kilograms. So you have 100 kilograms of that hamburger in your hands. It's pretty heavy. How much of that must be fat? 30 kilograms, right? 30 kilograms. That's why I put the 100 on the bottom. If it's out of 100, the percentage must just be the number. The 30 must just be the number. If it's out of 100, it must be 30 out of 100 to be 30%. Does that make sense? So let's say we had 100 grams of hamburger. So we just had 100. What number goes up here? 30 grams. So those are conversion factors, right? Does that make sense? Now, what if I had a ring that was 15% gold? So a ring is 15% gold. What does that percentage mean?
The whole ring
is gold. Gold, right? So if this ring you have, 15% of whatever's in that ring is gold. 85% is something else, right? So that means then if I had 100 kilograms of ring, which you don't, I know you don't have a 100 kilogram ring, I know that. So if you had a 100 kilogram ring, 15 kilograms of that 100 kilograms would be gold. You could say it another way. You could say 15 grams out of 100 grams would be gold. You could say 15 milligrams out of 100 milligrams is gold. Notice how the units have to be the same top and bottom, usually. I'll show you exceptions to that, but for right now, let's keep them the same. That's what it means. Now, what if, because it's Friday, probably shouldn't say this because I'm being recorded. What if you go to the adult beverage store to buy an adult beverage? And it says 40% alcohol by volume. What does that mean? Of the whole thing, 40% of that bottle is alcohol, right? So now we're dealing with a liquid. So you're not going to use mass, you're going to use volume. Does that make sense? So if something is 40% alcohol, usually it says on the label, it'll say by volume, because they have to specify that on the bottle by law. If it's 40% alcohol by volume, that means if I had 100 milliliters of vodka or rum, 40 milliliters of that will be ethanol. Okay? Does that make sense? Everyone follow that? If I had let's say I had 100 liters. 40 liters of that would be alcohol. Does that make sense? That's what those numbers mean. Okay? So that's as easy as pie, right? You don't think about that, do you? Is that okay? All right, let's crank them out. Body fat, so if you're 11% body fat, if you had 100 kilograms of you, 11 kilograms of you would be fat. If there's 100 milligrams of you, 11 milligrams of you would be fat. Does that make sense? I don't know if that's healthy or not. You don't have to know this for your exam. I don't ever test on part per million and part per billion. I just kind of tell you about it because it's in the news a lot. Part per million is basically you have a milligram of something and a kilogram of something else. So say you have in front of me, there's a kilogram of water. So I have a big old kilogram of water. I'm holding it in my hands. Inside that kilogram, let's say there's one part per million lead. So inside that vat of water I'm holding, there's a total of 1 milligram of lead, if there's one part per million. If there's 10 parts per million, then there's 10 milligrams of lead in this container. Does that make sense? That's what the words mean. So one part per billion, now it's a microgram. So if I had a kilogram of water in my hands and I had one part per billion, then inside the vat of water, there's a microgram of lead or arsenic or whatever hazardous material you want to talk about. Okay? Now, I was going to be honest with you. Unless you know the tolerable dose, water has a whole bunch of stuff in it that you don't even know. It's just so low that it doesn't really matter. You know, if it's down in parts per trillion, is it toxic or not? I mean, I don't know. You have to ask a toxicologist, right? Okay. Don't worry about part per million, part per billion calculations. I don't test on it. But I just want you to kind of know what it is, because if you ever hear it on the news. Okay. Equalities. a little quick little tip for you. Equalities can be written as fractions or ratios, one over the other, and you get two conversion factors per equality. 1 gram is a sorry, 1,000 grams is 1 kilogram, or 1,000 grams over 1 kilogram, or 1 kilogram over 1,000. That's just how it is. Equality, two conversion factors. Let's get to some examples. Don't worry about LD50, problem solving. Problem solving, here we go, that's where I want it to be. We'll do one quick example, then we'll take a break, then we'll come back and do a whole bunch more. Here's the strategy that a lot of people like to employ. I have adopted this course. I used to have a different strategy, and I use this because I want to teach it to you guys because it works really well. If you're given a word problem, and you'll be given a few of them, quite a few of them, you read the question carefully twice. Read it once without writing anything down. Don't write anything down. Just read it. And then read it again and start pulling out pertinent information. So for example, if I read this question, a person has a height of 2.0 meters, what is that height in inches? Okay, I read it once. My mind's already churning away on that question. My mind is thinking about ways to answer it. My mind is going 1,000 miles a minute in the background. Then I read it again carefully. A person has a height of 2.0 meters. So length or height, whatever you want to say, 2.0 meters. I'm making a little list, because I don't know about you, I get confused when I read word problems. I'd rather pull out the pertinent information and leave the rest behind. Because a lot of times, and you've probably already seen this, a lot of times in a word problem, you get a lot of extraneous information, just information that's just there. You don't really require it. It just kind of sits there to confuse you. Okay. A person has a height of 2.00 meters. What is that height in inches? So length equals question mark inches. Always write down what I need as a question mark. You could write it as x. I don't really care. And then I write the units and I double underline it, or I try to remember to double underline it to remind myself how critical the unit is. Length. You could put height if you wanted to. You could put distance. Just remind yourself what it is. I don't really care how you do it. If you even have a different method than this, you can use a different method as long as it gets you to the right answer and it's logical. Okay? Okay, so now I look at that and I say, okay, what am I given? I'm given meters. So given, that's what I'm given. The problem gave me meters. I know I have 2.0 meters. And I need, or I want, inches. So I'm in meters. I want to get to inches. Don't look at numbers. Don't look at any. Just look at units. Now, if you've learned it a different way in high school, it's probably OK. But I know ways to make you wrong. So please, I would just learn this way. It's going to help you. And I think the nursing school uses it this way. I don't know though for sure. I'd have to ask them how they do it. I have a meeting with the dean of the nursing school in a couple of weeks. I will ask him there. Oh, that leads me to the thing. If you have any questions you want to ask the dean of the nursing school, email me and I will ask him for you. You can make a meeting with him too, I'm sure. I don't know if he'll see you or not. But I'm going to meet with him in 2 weeks. So if you have any questions for him, or maybe it's next week, email me and I'll ask him and I'll bring you back the answer. Okay. You're given meters, so write that down. Just meters, just write it down. Multiplied by something equals inches. So every question I do, I write down the unit, multiplied by something, put a line there, equals the unit I want to be in. So here's what I'm given, here's what I need. Meters will be multiplied by something to give us inches. Meters multiplied by something to give us inches. And we have no idea just yet what that something is. But we can figure it out. So what do I want to do? Well, I want that unit to be gone by the time I get here. So how do I do that? Put it on the bottom. Outstanding. So now, mathematically, they cancel, right? The units will just cancel out. Does that make sense? I want to be in that unit. So what do?
Put it on top.
So now if I multiply this by something, I should get inches, right? At that point, I would go to my little table of equalities that I'm going to give you, and I would look for it, see if it's there. I would look for something that relates inches to meters. And I would see if there's something there. I don't actually know what it is. I'd have to look it up. I don't know it offhand. On your formula sheet, there would be one. Yeah. Do you have it there?
No, I was going to ask you, isn't it 3 feet in
a meter? No. No, there's not exactly. I don't know what it is. 3.1 something. Does anyone have that conversion factor? I don't have it right offhand.
Is it 1 meter?
39.
Oh, there it is. What is it?
39.4
inches. 39.4 inches and 1 meter. Right. Thank you. So there's 39.4 inches and 1 meter. See, I don't even know this stuff. I have to look it up. And you'll have it on the. You do not have to memorize that. It'll be there. Okay. Now, I put inches is right here. So 39.4 must go right here. And the number 1 must go there. Easy, right? And then the number I'm given goes over here. 2.0 meters multiplied by 39.4 inches. For a grand total of, somebody? Louder, please. 78.8. That's what the calculator gave you, right? But now I have 2 significant figures here and 3 here. My answer has to be in 2, right? So the answer would be 79. You don't round to that. This number here is considered exact. So it's in exactly 1 meter, there is measured to be 39.4 inches. That's the top number is a measurement, the bottom number is considered exact. All right? All right, take a break. Back in 10 minutes, and we will hit this again. We'll do a whole bunch of examples of this today. So, conversion factors, equalities, and all that jazz. Before we move on to that, let's talk a little bit about the math quiz online. I sent an email. Next exam, first exam, if you wrote the math quiz. So far, the response has been underwhelming. 9 people or so have written, please go write that quiz. Whether you get 100 on it, you're going to get 5 points on the next exam just for doing it. It's for in your benefit for 2 reasons. If you're Yeah, so remember, check your Broward email, because I send you stuff like that every now and then. I don't normally announce it in class, because I've already announced it via email. mail.broward.edu, that's where it's going to go. So check it. Okay, so write the math pre-quiz online. It's 5 bonus points towards the next exam, whether you pass or fail it. Do it.
So to get a hold of you, we would email you through that, not
D2L. Either way, my Broward.edu, I'll answer faster. D2L, I'll answer slower. There is one on Master in Chemistry. That's not the one I'm talking about. The one I'm talking about is on Desire to Learn. The one on Desire to Learn is shorter. It's like 12 questions.
You said on our next exam, what are you talking about?
Exam 1.
So nothing about our morning quiz.
No.
You want us to write it down in paper?
Nope, online.
Answer the questions.
Yep, it's all online. The whole thing's online. And then I'll look at it and I'll grade it. And then if you don't do so well on it, I'll refer you to the LRC for tutoring and math. Because the one thing that kills a lot of students is they can't do math at a high enough level.
It's under assessment?
Yep, it's in the assessments area. Okay? And the assessments, don't forget about those. Those count for 15% of your final score. All right, that being said, on Tuesday, whenever I get to them on Tuesday, that will be the last time you can write it. So once I look at them and I grade them on Tuesday, I'm not even sure what time that'll be. It might be before noon. It might be in the middle of the night. I don't know. Tuesday is when I'm going to grade them. So get them done before Tuesday, because after that, I'll still grade it, and I'll still refer you to help for the mat for extra tutoring, but I will not give you 5 bonus points unless you get it done before Tuesday. So get it done Monday night. What? The math pre-quiz. You'll get 5 bonus points if you complete it before Tuesday. Don't ask me to open it up again for you to get bonus points. If you don't finish it by Tuesday, you will not get 5 bonus points. finish it before Tuesday.
The assignments.
The assignments are not for credit. Those are for practice. Okay. The assessments are online. Yep, because the answers are given to you too.
Okay, but
no, no, no. Well, the answers are given, so you know, you're going to get 100. Good job. Okay?
The answer key for the first assignment.
It's there. Take a closer look.
Yeah, it's the last one, but I check.
It's
the assignment was 14 questions.
The assessment. The assessment, the assessment is graded for credit, so the answers are not given. The assignments are practice. The answers are given.
Okay, yeah.
All right?
The assessments are, it said you can take it 5 times.
Yep, you have 5 chances to get 100%. So there's no excuse. All right, we are going to write this one together. How many minutes are 5 hours? This is a pretty common question. So now, we are going to use equalities to get to the final answer. Now, sometimes, in fact, a lot of times, when you do conversions, let me make sure that I turn this camera on. Did everyone see the video posted last week?
No.
Well, you might want to look at D2L more often. It's there. Okay. We are in 2.5 hours. So we can't convert hours directly to minutes. Or can we? Do we know a conversion factor that converts hours to minutes? 1 hour is 60 minutes, so we know a conversion factor, right? Or an equality. So let's read the question. How many minutes are in 2.5 hours? Okay? So given time equals 2.5 hours. We need time equals question mark minutes. Min. Let's just drive min. Okay? So, we need to go from hours to minutes. So, don't even worry about numbers. Just think about units. We are given hours. Multiplied by something will give us minutes. All right. So that means we better put the hours on the bottom. So they'll cancel. Now we need to know minutes, so we put minutes on top. So now if we do this multiplication, we'll divide by hours, multiply by minutes. We know, everyone in this room knows, that 1 hour equals 60 minutes. So the number 60 will go here. The 60 will follow the minutes. The number 1 goes on the bottom. And the 2.5 would go there. So you'd multiply 60 by 2.5, and your calculator gives you 100 and what?
50.
Is that answer correct? Why is it correct? What? I couldn't hear you. Okay, so how many significant figures there? How many people think it's one? How many think it's more than one? Why do you think it's more than one? It's actually infinite. Why is it infinite? It's an exact number. Why isn't it an exact number? Because it's not an equality. Some equalities aren't exact. It's a definition. We define 1 hour to be 60 minutes. So it's an exact number because it's defined. Okay? So there's 24 hours in a day. That's an exact number because a day is defined to be 24 hours. Does that make sense? A minute is defined to be 60 seconds. So that's an exact conversion. Does that make sense? So you wouldn't round here because that's an exact number, two significant figures. So the answer must have two, and that one does. 150 is two sig figs. Does that make sense? All right. Let's take that same question. And you guys are going to minutes. Actually, I'll work this one with you because this was a little tricky. I want to go to seconds. So I'm in 2.5 hours. I want to go to seconds, not minutes. So let's set that up. Sometimes, and you know, you'll see it, you have to do more than one step in your conversion. Because I honestly don't know how many seconds are in an hour. I could figure it out, but I may as well just do the equality stuff. So I know there's 1 hour and 60 minutes. Do you know an equality that relates minutes to seconds? What is it? 60 seconds in 1 minute. So in 1 minute, there are 60 seconds. And this number is measured or exact? Exact, because it's a definition. So, we have hours. Oops, H-O-U-R-S multiplied by something. Now, let's be careful here. Let's be careful. Sometimes it's just a one-step conversion, bada bing, you're done. Sometimes, however, we have to go from hours to minutes here because we don't know how many seconds are in an hour. We have to go from hours to minutes. And then we must go from minutes to seconds. So this is going to be a two-step conversion. Now there's two ways you can do these. You can do them stepwise, this to that gives me this, and then convert this all the way to that. Or you can do it as one big line, one big sequence. I prefer one big sequence because I'm just going to use my units. So now, I know hours. So hours for sure has to go here. Why do I know hours has to go there? Because in the answer, it's seconds, not hours. So hours has to cancel away. So hours, first things first, hours got to go there. They got to, because they got to cancel. So then, if I'm going to relate it to hours, this is the only equality I know that relates hours to minutes. That's the only one I have. I don't have hours to seconds, so I have to use hours to minutes. I have no choice. So then I put minutes up here. But that's not good, right? Because we don't want to be in minutes. We want to be in seconds. But this conversion here puts us into minutes. And that's when you're like, come on, man. Give me an easier conversion. Until it hits you. Hey, wait a minute. All I got to do is multiply by something else. Multiply by something else. Now, minutes are up here. We don't want minutes. We want seconds. So we'll put minutes on the bottom here. And the minutes will go away. They'll just cancel out, just like that. They're gone. The equality that we have that relates minutes to seconds is right there. So you have to put seconds up here. You have to, because that you have a minute to second equality. So they have to go together. Does that work? Do the units work now? Yeah. Notice how I didn't use one number. I just used units. The units will guide you home as long as you trust them. Okay? Now, we know here minutes and hours. So we look at our conversion. So 1 hour. So the number 1 goes with the hour. The 60 goes with the minutes. Down here, minutes and seconds. The 1 goes with the minutes. The 60 goes with the seconds. So far, so good? Now, bust out your calculator. Sorry, forgot one thing. Oops. 2.5 goes over here. 2.5 multiplied by 60 multiplied by 60 again. And that should give you an answer. What is it? 9,000? Really? Freaky. Okay, that number's not right though, is it? Why is that number wrong? You have to be in two significant figures because this number is two significant figures. Okay? So how do I convert 9,000 to two significant figures? There it is. You got to use scientific notation. Right now, as it's written, that's one significant figure. If you put a decimal point there, that's four significant figures. If you stuck it in here somewhere, well, that's $90. That's 900. You know, you got to put it in scientific. So the answer would be 9.0 times 10 to the 3 seconds. You see how you have to use scientific, sometimes you just got to put it in there. All right, a little take-home quiz, question? A little take-home quiz, or not a quiz, a little problem you should work out on your own. Nope. I'm giving character. But I'll tell you this, if you can do this conversion, anything I can give you on an exam, you'll have no problem with. How many seconds in 1 year? Try this at home. In 1 year, 1 year equals 365 days. And we're going to define that for this question to be exact. A year is not exactly 365 because we have these things called leap years, but for this question, we'll define it as being an exact number. Okay? So at home tonight or sometime over the weekend, you know, when you're bored, crank that question out and see how many seconds are in exactly 1 year. And then come back next week and remind me, please, and I will go over it on the board. So make sure you try it. If you can do this, you'll probably be pretty good at anything I can give you because they're not going to get much longer than that. Okay, here's a question. I want you guys to work on this on your own. A rattlesnake is 2.44 meters long. How many centimeters long is the snake? So now I will give you the metric conversions on the board. Keep in mind, for an exam, you will have to know them. But for now, because I want you to work on the qualities, I will just give it to you on an exam. So there's all the distance conversions I've ever said to you before. So give it a go. Give it a go. Set it up the way I've shown you so the units will all cancel out. And give it a go. For those of you who may not want to use units, you may just want to jump to an answer. That's fine. But you're going to do, you're not going to get full value on an exam. So if it, say a question like this is worth 5 points and you just gave me an answer, you just wrote an answer down, you get 1 out of 5. Even if the answer is right. Show me your work. Showing off.
Is my PC logged in?
I honestly don't know. What was your question again?
If the BC I'm trying to get to it, every time I get to it, I get this. You said that's where the math question is.
Oh, it could be. It could be something with your computer. I'm not sure. You're asking the wrong guy about computers. That's where they'll be, yeah. My solution to computer problems is hammer. I would do is read a book, you know? Forget that. How'd you do? Did you all fit? Not hard, right? All these questions are just like this. Some of them get longer, but they're all kind of like this. All right, so you're given the length of a snake, L. Is 2.44 meters. That is one really big snake. You want the length to be in centimeters? Question mark. So that's where we want to be. We want to be in centimeters. So now, we know we have meters. Multiply that by something will give centimeters. So we put the meters on the bottom because that's what we want to go away. Put the centimeters on the top because that's what we want to be in the end. That's it, right? That's the setup. 2.44, 1, and 100. Multiply that by 100 and you'll get 244 centimeters. That's not hard, right?
No.
Not hard, is it? Not hard. Okay, there's another example here. If not, I'll give you one. Oh, here we go. Oh, we just did that one. That's kind of boring. I want to give you one that's more exciting. I'll give you one that's more exciting. Whoops. Okay, leave this for now. We'll do this in a second. I'm going to give you one that's more exciting. Conversions could ever be considered exciting. What if I give you this? What if I say you have 24 centimeters cubed, and I want you to tell me how many? So given, I need ? And centimeters cubed. Now that is a pretty easy question. But it seems it's a little bit daunting because a lot of students don't want to use units. They want to jump to an answer. So here's how you would look at these kind of questions. We're in centimeters. Okay? We're going to multiply that by something way over here. That's going to give you a hint. A few steps involved here to give us something. Okay? Now there's easier ways to do this. I'm going to show you the longer way, because I want you to see how even questions like this, if you don't use your units, you can get really messed up. So now, I'm going to put centimeters on the bottom and millimeters on the top, because I know that there are 10 millimeters and a centimeter. Now again, there's an easy way to do this, but I'm trying to illustrate a point, how you can just crank out the units to get where you want to be. So far so good, right? I've just set that up. Everyone's content with that? Everybody?
Yeah.
So if I do this, just looking at the units, if I do this, what's my new unit right now? What is it?
Centimeters
squared. Anyone else? So I'm dividing by that, multiplying by that. Right. Centimeters squared, millimeters. That's my new unit. Does everyone see that? Can everyone see how I got this? I take centimeters cubed, I multiply it by this, so the centimeters are going to cancel. So you'll get centimeters squared, because one of the centimeters goes away. I'm multiplying by millimeters, so now I have millimeters here. Does everyone see that? That's the wrong unit, isn't it? I mean, it's getting there. I've got millimeters, but I need three of the darn things, right? So I got to keep on going, don't I? Does that make sense? Got to keep trucking. So then, what if I were to just, let's get rid of that. But do you see how my unit that I just did right there told me I wasn't done? I was going in the right direction, but I'm not done. So let's do it again. Multiplied by millimeters, centimeters. So now, I'm going to divide by centimeters and by centimeters again, right? Everybody? Centimeters cubed, divide it by centimeters, divide it by centimeters. Does that make sense? Everybody? Yeah, sort of. What? Aha! It gives me centimeters, millimeters, squared. That's still not the right unit. But are we going in the right direction? We are, aren't we? Because centimeters are going down, millimeters are going up. But the units still aren't right. So what do we got to do? Got to do it again. Right? You keep going until the units work. Okay? So let's do it one more time and see what happens. The units have to work, and the units will tell you when you're wrong. They'll tell you in no uncertain terms. Okay. So now we have centimeters cubed, dividing it by centimeters again, dividing it by centimeters again. So now the centimeters are gone. We've eliminated them, haven't we?
Yeah.
Millimeters are multiplied by millimeters is multiplied by millimeters. So that's millimeters cubed. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Do you see how the units led me to the right direction? Does that make some sense? You can do that with any question. Use the units. The units will always tell you when you're right, and they tell you when you're wrong. Okay. Let's fill in the numbers real quick. 24 millimeters, 10 over 1, 10 over 1, and 10 over 1. So that's going to be, who's got it? 24,000 millimeters cubed. Make sense? Everybody? It's not that bad, right? It's just units, right? All right. Let's look at this question here now. Now, there is a good question. If your pace on a treadmill is 65 meters per minute, how many minutes will it take you to walk a distance of 7.5 kilometers? You got to be real careful with that question. Let's look at it again. Let's read it carefully together. If your pace on a treadmill is 65 meters per minute, is that an equality?
No, that's a rate.
It is a rate, actually. A rate is also an equality. If you have, if you're on that treadmill and you walk on that treadmill for 1 minute, how far have you gone?
65.
Exactly. So 1 minute equals?
65.
Exactly. There you go. Good job. So that is an equality. Okay, 1 minute equals 65 meters. How many minutes? So that's my question mark. That's where I want to be. I want to know minutes, so that's what's needed. Will it take for you to walk a distance of 7.5 kilometers? So that's what's given. So I have a rate, I have a distance, or given, and I want to know time. All right, let's write all this down. Let's write it down carefully, and that way we won't make any mistakes. And we're going to use our units. We're going to use our units to guide us from one way to another. And we're going to listen to our units. All right, so we're given distance or length equals 5 kilometers. And we want to know time. So time equals question mark, and the question mark is in, yes it is, minutes. So we're given 7.5 kilometers, and we're told the time is not known, and that's what we want to know. I guess we want to know Tim. Time in question mark minutes, and we're given inequality. 65 meters equals 1 minute. All right, there we go. Go ahead.
Are you thinking of being asked a question?
Excuse me?
Are you
You may not be given the equality in the question because it may be given to you on the sheet on the back of your exam. But yeah, you have to have it. You have to have a given equality, and you have to have a needed, or well, you have to have two of those three, or else you can't answer these questions. So if on an exam you're only given two, like you're given needed and a given, then go look for the equality on the back. Okay. And if it's not there, write on the exam, hey, this can't be answered because you didn't give us the equality, and you get full value. That doesn't happen very often. Okay, so here we go. We want to set this up. So we want to we're in kilometers, and we want to get to minutes at the end. I gave lots of room for lots of work. Maybe it's simple, maybe it's not quite so simple. So now we want to multiply kilometers by something, don't we? We want to multiply it by something. Now, what are we going to put down here? What?
Kilometers.
So kilometers got to go there. What's got to go here?
Minutes.
Aha! Someone said minutes. You're not the only one thinking minutes. If you put minutes there, do you have an equality that relates kilometers to minutes? No. What do you have? Minutes. Meters, not kilometers. What do you got to do? We have to do what now? We got to convert kilometers to meters. Why? Because we have a relationship between meters and minutes. We want to get to minutes, right? So we got to use this equality somehow. This equality is written in meters, not kilometers. Be mindful of the units. Be mindful of the units. So we put meters up here. Kilometers will cancel. Okay? Now we'll be in meters. So far, so good? Now we can use our equality up here, because now we are between meters and minutes. Meters cancel. Does that seem to work? We go from kilometers to minutes using the pace on the treadmill. Does that seem okay? Fill in the numbers. 7.5. 1,000 meters and a kilometer, and 65 meters per 1 minute.
Also, it wouldn't be 60
meters. What's that? No. All right, so 7.5 multiplied by 1,000 divided by 65. Who's got a calculator? Louder? I can't hear you. 115.38 is what the calculator tells you, right?
Mm-hmm.
Now you got to round it. So here we have two sig figs. This is an exact number, right? Why is this exact? It's a definition, someone said. Who said that? Good job. It's a definition. You're in the same system of measurement. So you stay the same. Significant figures, that is. Here there's two. So the answer has to have two. So the answer is, there it is, 120 minutes, or just basically 2 hours. Sounds good?
No, I'm confused. Why is it 120?
Aha! Because here we have two sig figs, and here we have two sig figs. So the answer has to have two, right? Two and two only.
Yeah.
Here's the number we're going to round away, the five. So this 5 is the first one around. Okay? And it's 115, not, so you can't say 12. It's 120. Okay? Very good question. All right, so everyone's comfortable, right? Say that question again. Mm-hmm.
You could just write that number instead of a whole number.
Oh, you mean just write what? Like write 120? No, you have to round it.
Right.
Like the number has to be rounded. But if you want to like look at the calculator and then just put the rounded number on your paper, that's fine as long as it's right. What most students do is they write down what the calculator gave them and then they round it.
Right.
That way, I guess they just feel more comfortable just doing it that way. But if you're comfortable just reading it off the calculator and rounding it in your head, I got no problem with that. As long as it's right. Problem is if it's wrong. That's where the problem comes in. All right, good. So everyone's comfortable, sort of? Now, trust me, and I'm not trying to be a jerk or anything to you. Trust me. As much as you think you know how to do these things, you don't. You've got to go home and practice how to do these things. You've got to. Desire to learn, mastering chemistry, and the assignments in the book, and the assignments online. Get at them. Don't wait till, you know, day before the exam. Get at them now. Like, get at them this weekend. I know it's a long weekend, but you certainly want to study this stuff. You want to get on top of it. Okay, let's try this question together. You're going to see that a lot of these questions is the same thing over and over again. Same thing. Just keep repeating the same thing. Just slight little twists on the question. Now we're giving a percentage by mass. But you know how to deal with that, right? We already talked about this. So, how many pounds of sugar are in 120 grams of candy if candy is 25% by mass sugar? This question's not as hard as you think, but it's not as easy as it looks. Let's read the question again. How many pounds of sugar? So that's my needed. So I need, pounds. So that's the English system of measurement. How many pounds are in 120 grams of candy? So I'm getting 120 grams of candy. Given 120 grams I want to convert the grams of candy to the mass of sugar using the percentage. So I'm told you're 25% sugar by mass. Excuse me. Okay, 25% sugar by mass. That means, if I have 100 grams candy, I have 25 grams of sugar. So 100 grams of candy, in that 100 grams, I will find 25 grams of sugar. Okay, so now, holy smokes, we want to convert grams to pounds. Oh, goodness, tough question. Dr. Betts, what's wrong with you? Go ahead. Well, let's use the units. Let's just use the units. I wish I could answer that question, but I don't know because I always just go to the units. I don't even want to think about stuff like that. I just want the units to show me where to go. I want to be led by the hand. Honestly, that's what I want to do. I get asked a lot of times questions like that, like, would we just multiply or would we just divide? And I'll say, I don't know. And you guys all think that I do know, I'm just not telling you. I honestly don't know. I have to use the units. I really do. Because I don't want to think about stuff like that. I want to be told what to do. Okay, so we're in grams of candy. Now, this is candy. And this is pounds of sugar, so let's be more exact. So it's pounds of sugar we need, right? How many pounds of sugar? Yeah. So we got to convert grams of candy to grams of sugar. And then we can convert that grams of sugar to pounds of sugar. Does that make sense? Does that seem like a good plan? So we'll have grams of candy. Let's just write this down. We're going to convert that to grams of sugar. And then we're going to convert grams to pounds of sugar. That's probably a good plan, right? Maybe. That's the best laid plan. We're going to work the plan. If the plan doesn't work, we're going to try a different plan. Okay. So we have 120 grams of candy. Grams candy. We're going to multiply that by something to give us grams of sugar. So let's put grams candy on the bottom and grams of sugar on the top. So now if we do that, right, we'll be in grams of sugar, won't we? Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Everybody? So the grams of candy go sayonara. And now we're in grams of sugar. But boy, oh boy, that's not right. That's right, but we're not done yet. Because we have to get to pounds of sugar. And how are we going to do that? Holy crap. I don't know the conversion factor. I'm freaking out now. Look in the back or in the exam. There'll be a conversion sheet there. Let me borrow your book real quick. Oh, you got it there? Tell me quick, because I feel embarrassed. it's in chapter 1.
Yeah.
Oh, it's written there? Oh, this is embarrassing. This is all on tape, too.
Yeah, 1 pound.
1 pound is 454 grams. That's good. 1 pound. 1 pound equals 454 grams. Okay, so there we go. So now I have a relationship between grams and pounds. So now I can convert this. So multiply that by something to give us LBS of sugar. So we're going to put grams of sugar on the bottom. Pound. Sense? Everybody? So grams of sugar go away, which is what we want, leaving us with pounds of sugar. So let's start putting in numbers. 120 grams of candy. We know that there are 25 grams of sugar per 100 grams of candy. We get that. So the 25 goes here. The 100 goes there. And then we're going to do this conversion factor. So we know that the 454 goes with the grams. And the 1 goes with the pounds. And that's how you do it. So you'd multiply 120 by 25, divide that by 100, divide it all, sorry, let me say that one more time. multiply 120 by 25, divide it by 100, divide it by 454. And that should give you an answer in pounds. What is it? Who's got it? 0.0667. That's probably enough. Okay, so here we have two sig figs, and here we have two sig figs. So the answer has to be in two sig figs. 0.067 pounds sugar. There you go. That's how you do it. That's the easy way to do it. There's numerous ways, but you don't want to do the hard way. You want to do the easy way, right? Okay, now. Hold on one sec, I'll get to you. I've done a whole bunch of different examples of conversion factor problems on the board. The last thing you want to do is say, okay, I got it, because you don't. I'm not trying to be mean, I'm just saying that you just probably don't have it yet. Go home, and I would start with the learning checks, the ones that I've done. Cover up my answer, don't look at the answer, work it out yourself. When you get stuck, go find out the answer, go see how to do it, see the logic behind it, and then don't just pick up where you left off. Get a new clean sheet of paper, start again. Force yourself to learn it. Force yourself to learn the steps, force yourself to learn the logic, and you'll be fine. But it takes some effort on your part. What's up?
I don't understand how you got to let Anne say.
I don't either. Someone told me. Is that correct or is that not correct?
It's not correct.
Come on, your calculator. I get all these conflicting numbers. You think I learned to carry a calculator, but I hate calculators. 5 divided by 100 divided by 454 equals 0.06607. Ha! Somebody told me a fib. Somebody lied to me. Story of my life. People lying to me. 9.2. So that's going to be 6.6. Somebody told me the falsehood. All right. Thank you. All right. Good question. So here, let's look at this number here. That zero is not significant because it's a holding a place. That zero is also not significant because it's called a leading zero. It's leading up to a number. So these two numbers are leading. The six is your first significant digit. So that's your first significant digit. That's your second one. So this is where you want to round it to. So it's going to be 0.066 because that's a zero. So that doesn't round up. These just kind of round off, or away, or however you want to say it.
So when we do the calculation, so we always start with the given, like right there.
Yep.
We always put that over there.
I would. But again, like, you know, do these questions enough, you're going to get your own little procedure to do, and one that makes the most sense to you. I just give you mine, and my procedure that I show you guys is very, very drawn out. Like, I give you all details that I can think of. When I do these questions for real, I probably do them on, like, you know, I probably don't do this much detail. But on an exam, and for you guys, because you're just learning it, you're going to want to give a lot of detail because it's going to be logical to you. And if you make a mistake somewhere in the middle of the question, I can see your detail that you knew what you were doing, you just made a small error. So instead of getting 4 out of 10, you get 9 out of 10 or 8 out of 10. See what I'm saying? Anything else? Go. Sure. So we got grams of candy, right? We're going to multiply that by this conversion factor because that relates grams of candy to grams of sugar. Remember, we're trying to get to pounds of sugar. What?
Would that be 0.75?
This? Yeah.
Okay.
Yep. Then you're going to divide that by 454 because that converts grams of sugar to pounds of sugar.
Oh.
Okay? So you're trying to get the final answer, a pound of sugar, or pounds of sugar. And that much candy. All right. Is that good? Fun, right? Math. Gotta love it. It's everywhere, and it never goes away, except for organic. And then you wish it was back. I'm serious. You will. Now, density. Write that word down. Density. Density is simply an equality. Now we write it as this formula thing, but really think about density as an equality. Density relates grams of something to the volume, the mass of something to its volume. Grams over milliliters. So, for example, water has a density of 1.00 grams per milliliter. I'll write that down for you. Density relates grams to our mass to volume. Mass to volume. Let me get a different color marker because my board's getting awful messy. What's that? Okay, so density. Equals mass over volume. That's how most people write it. They write it as an expression, a mathematical formula, as they say. I say, why not just say density is a relationship of mass equal to volume. It's the same thing, right? So then you can have mass over volume or volume over mass. You can express it any way you want. Mass equals volume, mass over volume, or volume over mass. Normally, typically what you see expressed is that. If you read, like in a book, if you're reading densities, you'll see it expressed as mass over volume. But you don't have to. You could write it as volume over mass. As long as you show me the units, it's correct. But on an exam, you're going to want to put mass over volume just because it looks nicer. It just looks more proper. Okay? So think of density as an equality and or a conversion factor. It makes these questions you're about to see so much easier. Okay. Let's just talk about this slide real quick. Here we have a beaker filled with water. Now, if you take some stuff, say for example you have a glass of water, and you drop an ice cube in that water. So you go to the club, your cocktail, and there's crushed ice in it. The ice floats to the top, doesn't it? The ice doesn't sink to the bottom, it floats on the top, doesn't it? The reason for that is because ice is more dense than water. Water is more dense than ice. So water will drop to the bottom, the ice will float to the top. If you ever go to the northern part of the country in the wintertime, lakes will freeze over. Ice will go to the top of the lake, not the bottom, which is good for the plants that live on the bottom of the lake. If you take that same glass of water and you drop in a piece of metal, say a coin, the coin won't float. The coin will sink to the bottom of the glass, right? Metal, most metal, I would say all metal, is more dense than water. Now, to be more dense, what does that mean?
Heavier.
Well, there's more per unit of volume. So say you have a 1 liter volume, it's more dense than water. So that 1 liter of water, say, will have a mass of 1 kilogram. 1 liter of lead will have a mass, say, of maybe 200 kilograms. I'm not sure what the density of lead is. I really don't know. But it has the same volume, more mass, than the more dense one. Dense just means there's more matter packed into the same volume. Does that make sense? Is that pretty cool or what? No one answers. No, it's not cool at all, Dr. Best. Thank you. It is cool. You just don't know it. Okay. So that's density. The more dense you are, you sink. The less dense you are, you'll rise. So if you put a cork into water, the cork will float on top of the water. Yeah?
Why is it, you ever heard that it's easier for bigger people to float on top of water than it is for skinny people to float on top of water?
Yeah, because fat's less dense than muscle.
Oh.
There you go.
Yeah.
See, you knew it. You knew that all along, right? I thought you were going to ask me another question. Well, how is it the Navy can sail these big ships made of metal across the ocean? That's not density, that's buoyancy. That's a different thing, okay? Density, this relates, density is grams per mil, and the more dense flips, more dense sinks. Buoyancy is the shape of the vessel to hold it above the water. It's a different thing. It has to do with surface tension and all that. Ask a physics guy. All right, so that's density. We've already gone over all this stuff. Let's do a calculation. Osmium, a very dense metal, What is the density in grams per centimeters cubed if 50.0 grams of osmium has the volume of 2.22 centimeters cubed? That's a lot of numbers coming at you at once. This is why I make tables. Okay, let's read it again. Osmium is a very dense metal. That's a throwaway statement. It's true, osmium is a dense metal, but that's not going to help us get to the final answer. What is the density in grams per centimeters cubed? So equals, question mark, grams per centimeter cubed. And remember, 1 centimeter cubed equals 1 milliliter. Okay, we have mass equals 50.0 grams. We have a volume. Volume equals 2.22 cubed. Now at this point, you might want to look. This will be written there. Density is m over v. D equals m over v. Density equals mass over volume. That will be written there. However, you don't need it. Why don't you need it? Because I've already told you the units right here. I want you to tell me the density, and the units are grams over centimeters cubed. You could just look at the density formula and do it that way, or you could do it this way. I have grams. I want to multiply it by something to give me grams over centimeter cubed. So how do I do that? Divide by centimeters cubed. Right? Does that make sense? Mm-hmm. I want this and that unit, grams over centimeters cubed. So all you got to do is divide the grams by the centimeters cubed. Does that make sense? It's just math, right? This is elementary math. So it's 50.0 divided by 2.22 centimeters cubed. The units, if you just look at the units will be grams over centimeters, won't they? Will they or will they not? Everybody?
Yes.
If you know. If you don't know, sit there quietly and raise your hand. Okay? You got it? So that divided by that must be correct because the units tell me it's correct. Does that make sense? The units led me to the right answer. I didn't have to look up a formula. The units told me where to go. Now, if you don't like that, go to the back of the exam, spend the time, find the formula for density, D equals M over V, and plug the numbers in. Mass, 50.0 grams divided by 2.22 centimeters cubed equals, and I have no idea, it's 20, 25 or 26 point something. Must be 22.5, right? Grams per centimeters cubed. All right? That's how it's done. Yeah?
So if the unit that you want to get into is smaller, you divide it.
What's that?
I said if the unit you want to get into is smaller, you divide it. And if the unit you want to get into is bigger than the unit you have, you times it?
Nope. Don't do that. I knew from the question I wanted to have density in grams divided by centimeters cubed. That's the units I want. So in order to do that, you're simply dividing the grams by the centimeters cubed. That's all it means. So grams divided by centimeters cubed. Okay? Good question. All right, anything else? Exactly right. I just don't say multiply by 1 because it's just going to give you this, like, 50.0 multiplied by 1 is 50.0. And then divide it by the denominator. Yep, that'll get you the right answer. If you type that into your calculator, you'll get the same answer. Mm-hmm. Good question. Anything else? All right, let's do another question. Write this down. Volume by displacement. Write that down. Very interesting thing that scientists do. Now, I'm going to tell you a little bit of folklore. I like to tell some stories sometimes, especially when it's something kind of funny. This is a folklore story. It's kind of a legend, maybe a myth. It could be something, probably just a myth. Huh?
Was
Yeah, sure, go ahead. Now, there's a story, and this is how the story goes. Now, I don't know if it's true or not. The story goes that there was a king, and kings back in the day were probably somewhat crazy, power mad or whatever, had a crown, and the king didn't know for sure that his crown was made of absolute pure gold. And he wanted to know, because people want to know crazy things. So he calls in his court, probably the court magician, because court magicians back then were just alchemists or chemists. They could just make, you know, they could make things burn and stuff blow up and whatever. It wasn't magical, it was just good chemistry. And the king told his court magician to know, my crown is made of gold. And I want you to tell me. And of course, back then, when you're the servant of a crazy king, if you can't tell the king, curtains, right? Also, back then, they could tell if it was pure gold. Easy to tell. But you had to destroy it. You had to take a sample of the gold and destroy it. Now, crazy king ain't going to like that, right? He's going to freak out if you destroy his crown. So the scientist, as the legend goes, or the magician, was probably very stressed out about this whole phenomenon, because now his life is probably in jeopardy. He has to figure out if this crazy crown is made of gold, and if it's not, or he can't figure it out, the king's probably going to freak out on him. So you can imagine, he's last day on earth, the night before he takes a bath, you know, because he wants to be clean for his execution, or whatever. He gets in the tub. Now everyone in here, I hope, has had a bath at one point in their life. If you haven't, try it. It's fun. Now, when you get in the bath, the water's there, it's nice and warm, you put your feet in, and you sit down in the tub. What happens to the water? It rises. Now, have you ever thought about this? The volume that you displace, like your body displaces, so you sit in the water and the water moves to accommodate you. Your volume, say you're displacing, say you're adding to the tub, say 15 liters of volume. You're actually displacing 15 liters of water. You ever think about that? If you add 15 liters of volume to the tub, the water must move or must gain 15 liters in volume. This is going to accommodate you, right? That's why if you fill the tub too high, it'll overflow, and your mother will yell at you. Okay? So think about that. So when the jester sat down in the tub, he noticed that too. He's like, hey, wait a minute. I get in the tub, my volume displaces the water. And then he did some experiments. And he figured out it was a one-to-one displacement. So if I put a liter of something into 10 milliliters of water, I now have 11 milliliters total volume. Right? Does that make sense? So that's called... Now, why is that important? Well, crowns are not perfect shapes. Crowns, they got little doodads and little graphic things on them. They're not perfect. Because we all know you could take a box, right? Measure the length, width, and height, multiply everything together, get a volume. You could do that with a box. Try doing that with a stone. Try doing that with a piece of jagged metal. You can't, right? There's no possible way to do it to get an accurate number. But you could throw it in water and measure the volume displaced. See what I'm saying? And that's what the chemist or the scientist in the court, the king's court, supposedly did. He took the crown, he weighed it, got a mass, got a volume. He knew both of those things. He knew the density. The density of gold at that time in history would have been known. So he could compare the two. And I don't know what happened. The end of the story got lost in history probably, because it's all probably just made up. But it's a great story, right? I've told that story numerous times. I learned that in high school. I don't even know if it's true. It's just a great story. Okay. So why does that matter? Let's take a look at this example right here. In the two pictures, you will see a blue liquid inside of a graduated cylinder. A graduated cylinder, like I told you last time, is just a nice way to measure volume. So let's look here now. We look at that cylinder right here and we read the volume. The volume is 35.5 milliliters. So we start out with 35.5 milliliters in the bathtub. And then we take this little piece of metal here. Now it's a cylinder, So we could measure the volume with a ruler, but it'd be really hard. We take that piece of metal and we submerge it completely in the water. And then the volume of the water goes up. It went from 35.5 to 45.0. So now we know the volume of that piece of metal. It's very simple. Volume 1 equals 35.0. Oh, 35.5, pardon me. 35.5 milliliters. Volume 2 is 45.0 milliliters. Subtract the smaller one from the bigger one, 45.0 milliliters minus 35.5 equals 9.5 milliliters. That is the volume of that piece of metal. I got that just by subtracting volumes. Very simple. You can do that with anything. Anything you want to know the volume of, you can do that. You have a newborn baby, submerge them in water, don't do that. I'm just kidding, don't do that. That's really cruel, don't do that. But if you want to know how much your volume is, if you know how much water is in your tub, submerge yourself and get your friends to measure the difference in volume. That's how much volume you have. You probably don't want to know how much volume you have, it's a big number. Okay, so now we know the volume. To get the density of that piece of metal, we need to know the mass, because density, right? Density is mass over volume. So we have this. We need to know that. How are we going to get it? Scale. Put it on a scale. So you fish it back out of that volume, that water, dry it thoroughly, and you get a mass, 68.60 grams. So the mass, 68.60 grams. So now we have a mass. So density is 68.60 grams. Divide all of that by 9.5 milliliters equals, so one divided by the other, 7.2 grams per milliliter, or 7.2 grams per centimeter cubed. That's how you get a density via water displacement. That's probably the most common way of doing it. Because, for honestly, even if I had a little cube of metal that I could measure with a ruler, I would still do volume displacement because it's easier. And you get a better number. Depends how the question's worded. If the question says express your answer in grams per centimeter cubed, then obviously you got to put it in grams per centimeter cubed. But if it doesn't say, you could go in grams per kiloliter if you want. I would mark it right as long as the answer was right. You could do both if you want. Go ahead. Yeah. Centimeters cubed, 1 milliliter is 1 centimeter cubed. They're the same thing. So if you ever hear like on some medical drama, push 5 cc's, they mean push 5 milliliters. That's what they're saying. Cc is centimeter cubed. Alrighty? Anything else? Fun, right? Try this learning check, and then we'll call it a day. So give that a good try before you leave. What is the density, grams per centimeter cubed, of a 48.0 gram sample of metal if the level of water in a graduated cylinder rises from 25.0 milliliters to 33.0 milliliters after the metal is added? Excuse me. So go ahead and try that question on your own. Anybody got it? Who's got it? Who's still cranking it out? All right. Another, and we're dismissed for the long weekend. Don't forget to do the math quiz before Tuesday. I'm not sure when I will grade them on Tuesday. I may grade them at 8 o'clock in the morning. So get it done Monday. Get it done Monday. Or before Monday, preferably. After that, you can still write the quiz. There won't be any bonus points on the exam. All right, ready? Here we go. All right, so density is what we need. Density is mass over volume. We already have the mass. That's 48.0 grams. So we're going to divide that by volume. But now we have two volumes. Which one do you use? Well, the answer is you don't use either one. You have to subtract. So in the graduated cylinder, we start with 25.0 milliliters, and we end up with 33.0 once we submerge the object. So you subtract 33.0 milliliters, subtract 25.0 milliliters equals, what's that, 8.0 milliliters. So the 8.0 goes here. And that's going to give you an answer of 6.0 grams per milliliter or 6.0 grams per centimeter cubed. All right, that's it for today, everyone.